संजय सर आगे ऐड हो गए।
हेलो
संजय सर तो दो तीन मीटिंग में रहेगा, एक कार्टिलेज का मीटिंग भी है ना उनका।
संजय कौन सा कार्टिलेज का है सर?
त्यांचा आहे गुजरातचा काहीतरी आहे।
जिओ आहे
इम्पॉर्टेंट वुमन
जिओ आहे जिओ आहे
डॉक्टर शक्कर।
लेकिन दूसरा कोई मीटिंग कर रहे है पर्सनल लिया हसन उसको कुछ देर परमिशन पहले
आवाज नहीं आ रहा है सोनेंदु
कोई वेबिनार का पहले संदीप का परमिशन लेना पड़ता है ना।
हां
संदीप
अरे सर नहीं अपना दो ही जगह पे कमिटमेंट है सर, एक आईएएस एक आर्थ्रोस्कोपी एकेडमी और सनी को महाराष्ट्र ऑर्थोपेडिक एसोसिएशन बस।
चलो आई थिंक
आईएएस वाला
वी आर लाइव सर।
आईएएस का तो ओनर है यार, इंडियन आर्थ्रोस्कोपी सोसाइटी इज ओन बाय संदीप।
अरे सर क्या अभी
चलो
लाइव ऑन यूट्यूब
ना। वी विल स्टार्ट द मीटिंग। आई थिंक उमेश विल जॉइन अस इन सम टाइम। मिहिर यू हैव टू कोऑर्डिनेट द मीटिंग। वी हैव द स्पीकर्स इन द फॉर्म ऑफ डॉक्टर संदीप बिरारेस। डॉक्टर रंजीत विल जॉइन अस। रंजीत आर यू देयर? रंजीत इज देयर। रंजीत इज देयर। नामदेव इज देयर। अनिल पाटिल विल जॉइन अस सम टाइम एंड विनय पांडे इज देयर। सो अभय नार्वेकर, सोनेंदु, संजय त्रिवेदी इज देयर। अतिक वसदे विल जॉइन। जयप्रसाद इज गोइंग टू जॉइन इन 10 मिनट्स। तन्मय इज देयर एंड महिपुल इज जॉइनिंग।
A very good afternoon to all of y'all. On behalf of the Arthroscopy Academy and the Arthroscopy Study Group, we have yet another interesting academic discussion. And this time it's going to be basics of ACL reconstruction. Without wasting any time, I will call upon Dr. Sandeep Birares to start the proceedings. His topic being, do all ACL tears need surgery? Sandeep, you can start sharing your screen.
I'll just mute everyone, Sandeep.
Yes. So, good afternoon, respected all the viewers, teachers, and all the founder members of Arthroscopy Study Group of India and Arthroscopy Academy. I would like to thank for giving me opportunity to present this talk. So, do all ACL tears need surgery? So, I have nothing to disclose, and no conflict of interest. So when we look at these two pictures, so there are two set of different set of patients. One on your left side, child playing football, and right side, middle-aged lady walking, doing her daily walks. And both of these patients, if they sustain a ACL tear, then you have to manage accordingly for different management for these different set of patients. So when we decide to diagnose this ACL tear, so positive pivot shift test will rule out in ACL tear, while negative latchment test would rule out of the tear of the ACL. So that's how we can confirm the diagnosis of ACL. Now, when we look at the natural history, most of the literature is retrospective and has analyzed patients with chronic ACL disruption with knee symptoms. And there is a abnormal load and shear stresses on ACL deficient knee, and risk of late meniscal injury is also high. And most commonly lateral meniscus is most commonly involved with injury because of the firm attachment, And the osteochondral damage influences the prognosis and may be the precursor of the osteoarthritis. So natural history of the ACL varies from patient to patient. And when there is a partial ACL tear, most common treatment is conservative line of management, which includes strict rehabilitation protocol. High demand patients already did, high demand patients who have already done, adequate rehabilitation can be a candidate for the ACL reconstruction. Now, next set of patients is patients with ACL avulsion. So when we look at this Mayer's classification, out of these five types, the type one and type two, which can be managed conservatively with the knee extension plane, while type three A, B, and type 4 need surgical intervention. Now, when there is a complete ACL tear, there are various factors which are taken into the consideration, like age, activity of the patient, degree of laxity on physical examination, other associated injuries, and if there is any symptomatic instability on this patient. So this article by Paterno in 2017, have mentioned non-operative patient in ACL deficient knee. So they have mentioned screening to identify the potential copper using this particular tool. So this tool, which is one-legged hop test, incidences of knee giving way, self-report of functional survey, and self-report of global knee functional rating. And based upon these tools, they have given the scoring, like patients who presented with concomitant injuries who achieved minimum score of 80% limb symmetry, more than 80% on KOS and ADLS, more than 60 on the self-report of knee function, and less than or equal to one subjective report of knee giving way. So these patients were considered potential copers. That means they can cope up with the ACL deficient knee and there is no need for the operative care. So they have stated that the patients who live more sedentary lifestyle have less physically demanding occupation and without any no concomitant injuries to the knee, further compromising joint stability and joint health are typically the best candidates to succeed with this conservative treatment option. So potential copers can be managed with the conservative, provided they are in a sedentary lifestyle. So what are the various indications for ACL reconstruction? Young athlete, frequent locking, associated meniscus or ligament injuries, persistent pain, failure of rehabilitative protocol, and in low demand patients. So all these are the various indications of ACL reconstruction. Now, there is this article by Alford, which state that managing ACL tears, when to treat and when to refer. So they have given various other indications for the surgical reconstruction. So based on various other reason, I have outlined this table where patients are divided into various age groups and depending upon their various symptomatology, like is there any pain, instability, locking, and what we want to achieve. Is there any, we are planning to prevention of arthritis or there are any associated injuries. So we need to answer all these questions to decide about if the patient needs ACL reconstruction or not. So if age is 10 to 35 years and patient has pain, instability and locking, and do we really want to do something to prevent arthritis and if there are any associated injuries. Let's see what will be the treatment modality. So ACL reconstruction with this set of patients will be really helpful for long run. Now, when you look at the patient from 35 to over 50 years of age, especially in males with symptoms of pain, instability, locking, and also if we are contemplating arthritis prevention and if there are any associated injuries. So in that case, let's see what the literature says. So this is editorial commentary where they have a coined new term called as MAMILs, mammals, that is middle aged men in Lycra. So these are the middle aged men over 50 years of age, but still actively doing all the physical activities. Their physical activities level is very good and they are also involved into various athletic sports. So the answer is absolutely yes. These are the also good candidate for the ACL reconstruction. So that means even a patient above 50 years of age, still you need to consider ACL reconstruction for their athletic demands. Now, there is one more article where they have mentioned outcomes of ACL reconstruction with focus on older patients. So what does this article state? That optimal surgical results can in fact be achieved in older patients. So this is also in favor of ACL reconstruction, even in the older cases. So there is one more article where ACL reconstruction in over 50 years of age, they have reported very excellent results in these patients as comparable to those patients with a younger subset. So upper this age group. Then another, if you go by symptomatically, irrespective of any age group, if the patient has a locking, whether patient male is female, and any age group between 10 over 50 years of age. So what does this literature say? Do this patient need ACL reconstruction or not? Just merely with a symptom of locking. So this article has stated that extension block secondary to partial ACL tear on the femoral attachment of the posterolateral bundle. So in these cases, they do have done the ACL reconstruction, or they have treated surgically to remove this bone block, and the locking symptom of the patient was treated. So here, even though you have not done ACL reconstruction, but surgery was done to remove this block for the knee extension. There are certain conditions where fat pad adhesion lead to knee locking. So this 51 patient study where they have described locking episodes, and this treated successfully, and patient had, did better with the surgical procedures. Now, another most controversial thing or debatable thing is 35 to 50 years of age and females with pain, instability, and locking. And again, two other associated factors like associated injuries and prevention of arthritis. So what does literature say? So regarding this clinical characteristic associated with depression or anxiety among patients presenting for knee surgery. So literature clearly states that preoperative depression or anxiety is associated with worse preoperative pain, function, and general health status. So these patients might get better with psychiatric evaluation. So this very good article, are patient and surgeon expectations after ACL reconstruction realistic? So this article has stated that patient and surgeon expectations are similar to each other. And at 2 years of actual outcomes, however, there is no correlation between patient and surgeon expectation. So at 2 years, expectations by patient and surgeon is same after the ACL reconstruction. And further, there is no correlation between expectations and actual outcomes. So they have stated that surgeons do not have accurate patient-specific expectations of short-term outcomes after ACLR, and they cannot predict which patient will have worse outcome. So when you choose to decide, you have to be, do the patient needs ACL reconstruction surgery or not, you need to be very realistic, and approach should be patient-specific. So when we look at if there any literature for this prevention of arthritis, so what did we find? That there is a very long-term osteoarthritis rate after ACL reconstruction. So this study itself has stated that osteoarthritis has increased after ACL reconstruction. And what they have concluded that it is because of the status of the meniscus. So the residual laxity does in some way cause the osteoarthritis, but it mainly depends on the status of the meniscus. So meniscus has got more important role in prevention of osteoarthritis than the ACL. So when you are in your practice, you do get patient, they come with a question like, doc, do I need an ACL reconstruction? What happens if I do not reconstruct the ACL? So we can tell them very well that at 5 years, there is no difference between meniscal surgeries, rates, or osteoarthritis. And also in functional course in young active patients treated only with rehabilitation, or if they, we do early reconstruction or delayed reconstruction. So at 5 years, there is hardly any difference between the patient's functional course, even though we treat them conservatively. And then further to add that tear of the ACL in elite sportsmen who cannot alter their activity level, and in patients who have recurrent giving way of the knee in spite of adequate rehabilitation. So usually elite sportsmen can be good candidate for the surgery. So another question, doctor, what happens after my ACL has been reconstructed? So the literature does not support the prophylactic benefit of ACLR in reducing the rate of the knee OA. The initial impaction force that results in ACL tear often causes injury to the articular cartilage. So these patients, they may get symptoms on long term because of the injury which is due injury which is to the articular cartilage. So their symptoms are more because of this articular cartilage injury than the ACL symptom. So they have stated that men are approximately 1.5 times more likely than women to return to their either pre-injury level or sports. So a faster recovery is seen in the male. And return to sport observed ACLR was largely made on the basis of various factors like psychosocial hesitancy for the surgery, lack of self-confidence, fear of re-injury, and changes in priorities or personal expectation before and after the ACL reconstruction. So this study has again stressed that meniscal integrity plays an important role in the long-term functional outcome, and an ACL injury increases the patient risk of undergoing total knee arthroplasty later in life. So meniscus causes degeneration, and this risk increases with concomitant ACL injury. So this summary of data shown in this article is there are various questions and there are various levels of evidence. I will not go detail into this. So what is the risk of ACLR graft failure? What is the risk of ACL tear in normal contralateral knee at 2 years? What will be my future activity level? What is the risk of osteoarthritis? What is the success of meniscus repair during ACLR? What causes knee pain at ACLR? So all these questions needs to be addressed prior to planning your surgery. Then there are a few other questions like, will my knee feel stable after ACLR? What will be my range of motion after ACLR? Will I be able to return to sport? How will my knee feel? What is the best graft source? Should I use brace? What decreases the long-term outcome after ACLR? And will my results be same over time? So you need to answer all these questions before planning for the ACL surgery. So in summary, then after going through all these literature, so I would like to conclude that 10 to 35 years of age with pain, instability, locking, and even 35 to 50 years of age, male patients with these symptoms, you need to consider ACL reconstruction. But certainly, ACL reconstruction cannot be just prevention of osteoarthritis. But if there are any associated injuries, ACL reconstruction also can be or should be done while treating these associated injuries. But now, when there are the females, so sedentary lifestyle, so all these, you can see there is plus, minus, plus, minus. So in that case, you need to plan your approach subjective-wise, case-to-case basis. But obviously, if there is any locking, which needs to be treated surgically, either removing the block or planning the ACL reconstruction. And then more than 50 years of age, pain is not the criteria for ACL. Instability, yes, may or may not be. Locking, yes, may or may not be. But certainly, ACL in this age group should not be done just for the prevention of osteoarthritis, because degenerative phase has already started, provided patient is not an active athlete. And same goes with the associated injuries. So in conclusion, ACL reconstruction effectively addresses the instability and locking symptoms. ACL reconstruction in an arthritic knee has little value. ACL prevention after ACLR, there is no evidence to support. However, long-term results of relatively new procedures, that is anatomic ACLR, are still awaited, and we may be in favor of arthritis prevention. Thank you for your kind attention.
Okay, Sandeep, I think that was a very well topics were covered. I had a little question for you.
Yeah.
So you said that type 1 and type 2 ACL bony avulsions can be conserved. We also have a lot of patients coming to us with injury, and obviously we get an MRI done and it shows a partial ACL tear. Okay, these patients are not complaining of an instability, and neither are the tests for instability positive. So when the patient asks you, doctor, do I need surgery, or what do we say? And secondly, when they say, doctor, will that ACL heal from partial to complete, what do you say? What would be the future of these patients, you know?
Yeah.
For the partial exactly. ACL tear is not unstable, but they want to know the future.
Correct. So partial ACL tear and not unstable. And like as I said, I'll decide patient to patient wise. So considering patient is a normal sedentary worker or office goer, then in that case, I will certainly not advise him ACL reconstruction. Now, by using the criteria for the potential copers, I might assess them using these various instability cores and hop test, single leg hop test. And then I decide my approach for that particular patient. But if patient is a high demand athlete, then ACL reconstruction would be my choice for that patient.
Okay. Great. We have any other questions for Sandeep from the panel, from other speakers?
I have a question, Sandeep. How do you identify these people where you are not contemplating any surgery? Means, you know, copers and non-copers. Any of the criteria you are aware of?
Yes. So the scoring system, which is mentioned in 2017, actually that is the same mentioned by Dr. Noyes. But in 2017, the article by Paterno, they have mentioned about this. Copers and non-copers. So they ask patient to do, they see patient's laxity, then ask patient to do single leg hop test. And if patient, and again, if it is affecting patient's activities of daily living, then it fits in that criteria. Patient is able to manage very well all these criteria scoring system. Then that means they are copers. So they are able to cope up very well with this injury, with the ACL deficient knee. And they can be very well given the trial of conservative management. Now, I'm not saying that once you, like if patient is potential coper, that means he's never going to need the ACL reconstruction. But we can very well give trial of conservative management. If it fails, then that time ACL reconstruction can be considered.
Sandeep. So is there a time duration for which you are going to give a trial, like maybe 2 months, 3 months, 6 months?
Now there is no time duration. The one article which I quoted, where they have compared conservative management, acute and delayed ACL reconstruction. So at 5 years, they have not reported any difference in the functional scoring.
So, Sandeep, you will recommend the ACL reconstruction in acute scenario also now?
That's what. It's a subjective. If patient is a high demand athlete, then I'm going to, because patient will have a different expectations. So, in
but
that
still,
case,
I will if patient is in acute phase, if bone marrow edema is seen, still you will recommend ki, for athlete also you will go ahead and do acute?
No, Akiti. I always wait, treat conservatively, give a time at least 4 to 6 weeks, and then decide further plan of action. Provided if patient, if patient has a bucket handle tear, locked meniscus or something, then it might change. I am talking only about isolated ACL tear.
Okay, so we have any more questions?
Yes, may I ask?
Yes, sir. Most welcome.
Sandeep, very excellent review of literature, and you really crystallized the majority of the questions. Did you come across any articles wherein they gave us some criteria to identify the copers now but future non-copers, so that we can weed them out in the younger individuals and confidently offer them that you will certainly need a surgery, so why not today?
No, sir, I did not come across anything such.
Because that is the main question, actually. As I am growing old, more and more patients I am offering, that wait and watch. If you become unstable, we'll operate. So I tell them to wait for 6 to 8 weeks, sometimes even 3 months, if they are not completely normal. So two things happen then. Some of my younger colleagues aggressively operate, and patient comes and tell me, sir, you advise this, but I came to know that I'll have a lot of injuries and this and that, so I get operated. And secondly, some patients come back with the meniscus tear, in spite of me telling that if you feel not confident or if you have any episode of instability, that is the time where you should come and get operated as soon as possible and do not wait for actual injury to happen. So our patients are not very, you know, that intelligent, that their episode of instability or feeling of, you know, when they lose confidence, they come back and tell us. There are some patients who are in absolute denial. You can make out that there is a gross laxity, but they say, I am fine. And there are patients who will say, I only have pain. But when you tell them, do you run? Do you play sports? Funnily, I ask them, if some pickpocketer picks up your, you know, pocket which is full of your money, credit card, everything, would you have courage to go after him? Then when they blink and stop to think, I advise them surgery. And for the villagers, I tell them, if the rabbit dog comes after you, would you be happy to run or you would let him bite you? So, you know, we have known so many things about the ACL, but still we have not been able to crystallize, you know, future copers or who are going to be a long-term copers. So I am by and large afraid of, you know, telling people that you are coper, so, you know, you can wait. 35 and young, I blanketly tell them that I don't have any criteria by which I can tell you that you will be all right for rest of your life, so you need surgery. 35 and 45, I counsel them and take a decision, and then whatever they comes back with, I operate and I deny all responsibility of future consequences of cartilage or meniscus tear. 45 and 55, that is a difficult lot. Females, I generally don't really give much attention to. I just keep them postponing. But males, I pick and choose my battles. This is so far my experience. I would be happy to, you know, get opinion from my colleagues.
No, sir, it's very good, sir, because most of the literatures also have shown the same thing. Like what age group you mentioned, these are the patients who are the candidates, and patients also need to go psychiatric evaluation. Patients should not have hesitancy. No, so there are at level one evidence, sir. They should not have a fear of re-injury. They should not have a what we call it as a hesitancy. So all these things are also play very much important when you advise them surgery. So your approach is very correct, sir.
Sanjay, as you correctly said, now even what I do now, the patient comes to me, age of 30 years or 35 years, I have to recommend him for surgery because they are active people and they go back and they come back after 2-3 months after with a meniscus injury or something twisting type injury, and that time they will ask you why you're not told us.
Exactly. So exactly my experience.
35 years, we should recommend the surgery for them. Definitely after 4 weeks, we should wait for that. Let all the bone marrow edema get subsided, everything is fine. But in the age group of 35 to 45 or 50, this plus minus you can think of. Like you can judge them and then actually you can tell them.
And they are wise also, you know, most of them, they realize what we are trying to say. And they come back, and even if they have secondary injury, they don't blame me. Because they know in their heart. But younger individuals, they come and straight away put a blame on you. That, doc, you advise this and I have this injury now.
There are few YouTube questions, Sandeep, for you. That is, how far you should rely on MRI reports for partial ACL tears?
Oh, Manoj.
So, relying on MRI report on partial tear. So, I don't go ahead if MRI shows partial ACL tear. And straight away, I don't rely on that. I see the patient clinically, and if with the partial ACL tear, my approach is always conservative initially. So if MRI shows partial, and if clinically I am getting good gross laxity, then I might consider surgery. So MRI report partial, but it should correlate with my clinical findings.
Arun Gupta from Agra wants to know any prediction of this copper or non-copper. Means, you know, you can identify them, but is there any predictability index? How he is going to behave or how he is going to report? Yes, Sandeep?
No, I have not come across any such predictability index. How are they going to behave?
There is one paper. I mean, I was just going through the search because it is a very good topic. There is a paper by Hurd, AJSM, and they have identified, obviously it's a retrospective study, they have identified 832 athletes over which they found out that almost nearly 200 patients were copers and rest were non-copers. So by rule of Frank Noyes, it is one third of your clinical practice usually can cope, one and two third will need a surgery. So
Roshan, share that paper on this forum.
It's in AJSM, and they found out that almost 88 patients of those copers, they landed up in high level of athletic activity in spite of their non-operative line of management. So that is very surprising, and it came from the very famous group, Oslo group. So
And secondly, I want to tell, when MRI says partial tear, if symptomatically patient is unstable, I would trust patient more than the MRI report, because MRI has all intra-observer variation.
Correct.
And if ACL is not exactly normal, whatever way, you know, partial or whatever, patient is unstable, symptomatic or clinically unstable, I think we should favor patients.
Dr. Yash Shah wants to know how to decide surgery in bilateral ACL tears. So, do you have any formula, Sandeep? Bilateral ACL tears, how to decide, what criteria?
So bilateral ACL tear, if I have to operate, so I'll first operate one, and maybe after 4 or 6 weeks, I'll consider surgery for the second.
So always going to
unfortunately, I did not do literature research on bilateral ACL. I wish I would have. So next time, when I improve my discourse, I'm going to add that also. That's a very good point.
Sandeep.
Yes, yes.
Sandeep, the ACL compensators, do you think that these patients have partial ACL tear, some part of the ACL is intact, having some proprioception, having the stability after the ACL injury? Any literature support for that?
No, I have searched, sir.
Okay. Any genetic background of ACL deficient compensators? Do you have any literature on that?
There must be. So I need to. I will be doing search for this.
Yeah, I read long back. Genetic background of ACL compensators. There is a ACL non-compensators and ACL compensators. There is some genetic background. These people have this different background, especially males. And other thing is, when you are non-operating in this patient with the ACL deficient knee, so this patient will have the meniscal tears. So what is your opinion on that?
Yeah, so as I said, associated injuries in some cases
Not at that point of time, later. And I mean, from the literature, after 3 months, it starts more risk of getting a meniscal tears with the ACL deficient knee.
Please, in
ACL deficient knee, when you are not operating, these patients will get a more risk of getting meniscal injury.
Yeah, so as I said, all 100% patients, I don't consider that I'm going to operate them, or 100% not like I'm going to not operate them. So when I'm thinking of operating, then it is an individualized approach for the different patients, depending upon what are their activity levels. Now, if they have a meniscus, or if it is a grossly unstable knee, then that's the one of the indication for the surgical intervention. Now, if it is not grossly unstable and I have decided to manage conservatively, now that risk of re-injury doesn't go away, it stays. Because even though patient becomes completely normal, he's still going to get injured. And even we do reconstruct ACL, still patients get re-injury and re-tear the same operated ACL also. So that risk doesn't go away. But if patient is highly unstable, I might operate patient in earlier. But if I have decided to conserve, then I might see if patient gets meniscus tear at that point of time, then certainly that's the time when I'm going to operate the patient for both ACL as well as meniscus.
Yeah, so I'll just let you comment to what Dr. Jayaprasad asked. For me, a meniscal tear at 2 or 3 months post ACL tear, which has been conserved, is a sign of instability. A patient whose ACL we have conserved, thinking that it is an ACL independent knee, when comes with a meniscal tear, is a sign of instability. So
yeah, yeah. These patient, some patient, they will have a ACL compensation, yes, full because of the muscular contracture and other things.
Exactly.
So some people, they will have a micro motion. When they have a micro motion with some compensation, so they will have the risk, more risk.
Definitely.
That so is a problem.
So when these patients would come to us with meniscal tears and we take this patient to manage meniscus, we should do the ACL reconstruction. Because the micro motion itself is instability and the compensation is giving way and that knee is treated as a decompensated knee.
Mayor.
Yes, Vinay.
In that case, if somebody comes with a meniscal tear after 1 year after a so-called Cooper, so would you still consider it to be a non-Cooper in the first go, or he was a Cooper and then he became a non-Cooper?
See, Vinay, you have to understand, there are so many factors. At 1 year post ACL injury conserved, that a patient gets meniscal tear, a lot of factors. And then when you want to offer them a one-shot treatment and you are already going in, and today ACL surgery is not a very demanding surgery in our hands, I will definitely do an ACL reconstruction at that time. Because I believe a meniscal tear in an ACL deficient knee is a sign of instability.
I think we should move on to the next talk, Mihir.
Yes, so I think we had a very good discussion on the first topic, Sandeep. You generated a lot of discussion. We'll go ahead with the meeting. I'll invite Dr. Ranjit to share his screen and enlighten about the anatomical femoral ACL tunnel. Ranjit, you could start sharing your screen.
Yeah, you can go ahead, Ranjit. We can see your screen, we can hear you.
No, we cannot hear.
Ranjit?
No, I can see Ranjit's screen.
No, he's speaking, but we cannot hear.
Ranjit, we cannot hear you.
Ranjit, can you hear us?
He needs to unmute, I think.
No, he's unmuted. Just check your adapter, Jack.
Ranjit, you are mute. Pull your earphone out. Pull your earphone out from the laptop and speak directly into the microphone of the laptop.
Okay, now am I audible?
Yeah.
Well, then it's problem with the adapter.
Yes.
Okay, thanks for the opportunity by the arthroscopist. Again, for this talk. Now, femoral tunnel creation in arthroscopic ACL reconstruction. As all of us know, the purpose of ACL reconstruction is to restore intact knee stability and the normal knee kinematics. So correct placement of both the femoral and tibial tunnels is crucial to the prevention of the surgical failure. The femoral tunnel position influences both the knee kinematics and the graft length much more than the tibial tunnel position. And the femoral tunnel is easily malpositioned more frequently than the tibial tunnel. And the errors in the femoral site are more critical because of the proximity to the center of the axis of the knee motion. It's not moving, actually.
No, Ranjit needs to be unmuted.
Okay.
That's right.
Okay. So all of us know about the anatomy of the ACL, how it is attached to the medial surface of the lateral femoral condyle and the bundle concept, and what are the bony landmarks we have to identify before going for the tunnel creation. Now, coming to the history, this operation becomes anatomic with the two incision technique for ACL reconstruction in early 90s, and operations became less anatomic with the advent of one incision endoscopic technique for the femoral drilling in mid 90s. So the results in the graft which are non-anatomic and too vertical, they resulted in high failure rate. That's why a number of surgeons have recently advocated a lower femoral tunnel position as more anatomic. However, is lower necessarily more anatomic? Now, Markov et al. In their study in HSIM and JOR, they questioned the rationale for placing the femoral tunnel at a more oblique position in the nuts to reduce the pivot shift. So as such, there is no concrete consensus on the anatomical positioning of the femoral tunnel. However, we can stress the anatomical center of the native femoral insertion, which is primarily taken into account at the femoral insertion point. Coming to the osseous landmarks, so we have the most important lateral intercondylar ridge behind which all the ACL bulk is attached to the femoral condyle, and the lateral bifurcate ridge when we are considering the double bundle concept. Now, arthroscopically, if we are seeing from the AL portal, we are usually see the residence ridge, and we are not able to see the area most oftenly behind the residence ridge. So if you can see from the posteromedial portal, you can have the end-on view of the medial surface of the lateral femoral condyle, and you can identify everything. Now, the ruler method, we can find out the center of the ACL at a point 50% along a line drawn from the proximal articular cartilage border and the distal articular cartilage parallel to the tibial surface with knee at 90 degree of the flexion. By radiographic method like Bernard and Hettel, which is more popular, Machizuki method, Edward method, and Takahashi method, we can find out the insertion point of the ACL on the femoral condyle. Wonek et al. Recommended that when determining ACL reconstruction, one should consider positioning the tunnel at the center of the native ACL and also see the orientation of the collagen fibers and the insertion sites. Similarly, a systematic review published by Pfeffer et al. In 2011 showed that the anatomic center of the femoral ACL origin was 43% of the proximal to distal length of the articular edge. So the more acceptable concept is the ideal concept, where we should replicate the most ideal fiber within the native ACL, and it should be localized in the direct fiber subsection of the ACL origin based on the histology. It should be placed equidistantly from the bottom and top of the notch with a tunnel back wall that is 1 millimeter or 1 to 2 millimeter thick, and it should be equidistant between the PCL edge in the lateral femoral condyle articular cartilage, and it should eccentrically located high and deep within the footprint. It should be anatomic in that the ACL graft is within the native ACL origin, and to achieve a very low tension flexion pattern in the ACL graft that replicate the tension flexion behavior of the native ACL. So there are different techniques to create the femoral tunnel for the ACL surgery. These are the inside out techniques and outside in technique. The inside out techniques are transtibial technique, modified transtibial technique, enteromedial portal or anatomical technique for single bundle or double bundle, all inside sockets, and outside in techniques. Now, transtibial technique, as we can see, we create the tibial tunnel, and through the tibial tunnel, we are creating the femoral tunnel. So this is known as transtibial technique. And in transtibial technique, we go through the tibial tunnel, whereas in accessory enteromedial portal is used and through which we drill the tunnel in case of transportal or anatomic technique. So you can see the trajectory of both the guide wires, which are placed in two different tunnels, drilled through transtibial and through the enteromedial portal. So many of the papers, they still favors this trans-tibial technique, like report of Danish ACL registry. They suggest that the revision rate for failed ACL reconstruction for the anteromedial portal technique was 2 times greater than that of trans-tibial technique. And Piasecki et al. In his study, he suggested in American Journal of Sports Medicine that the femoral tunnel can be positioned in a higher anatomical manner using the trans-tibial technique itself, but it requires a careful choice of tibial starting position. So the key is to place the femoral tunnel in the correct position regardless of the technique. So through the trans-tibial technique also, we can make the jig a little bit more horizontal and more medial in order to hit the point on the femoral condyle. So regarding femoral drilling, Smith in his talk, he described a nice thing. When you are drilling through the trans-tibial technique, you are actually creating a oval tunnel at the mouth. You are not creating a round one. So actually the diameter of this oval may vary from the diameter of your rimmer. But as you go horizontally, then the rimmer size and your tunnel mouth size becomes equal. So that is why we prefer this anatomical method where we go horizontally. So femoral tunnel location should be as deep in the notch possible without violation of the posterocortical wall, and at least 1 to 2 millimeter of the intact wall should be there. Usually it should be at 10:30 or 1:30 position, but ideally you should go in the green zone. You should not go, touch the red zone. If you go above, two vertical tunnel will happen, and it provides good AP control, but impinge the PCL and lead to complications. Similarly, too low tunnel also lead to high graft tension. So we should remain ideal while creating the femoral tunnel. So here the anatomic tunnel before creating the transportal technique, we take this spinal needle 18 gauge and we see whether it is hitting right at that target, that is the ACL remnant fiber or your isometric point on the femur or not. And then we create the accessory anteromedial portal, and simultaneously we see whether our rimmer will cause articular scuffing or cartilage scuffing or not. If we are sure of everything, then we create the accessory anteromedial portal and identify the femoral tunnel point. And one more thing is, when we see from this anterolateral portal, most of the times we think that the notch is very narrow to accommodate our reconstructed ACL. So we'll end up with the notchplasty. So in that scenario, you should come very close to the patellar tendon, or we should see from the anteromedial portal so that we will have actual view of what is happening on the medial surface of the lateral femoral condyle. So here you are seeing from the lateral portal, and here you are seeing from the same thing from the medial portal. So always you should see from the medial portal and then you mark your point. So these are the videos where we went for the femoral tunnel creation by transportal technique. We see the ACL remnant. When you are not able to see the ACL remnant, then you mark your anatomical point by the calculation already described. And you should try to keep at least 1 to 2 millimeter of the intact cortex posteriorly. Many a times we take the offset jig to offset our femoral entry point from the posterior cortex according to the graft diameter, and we mark it. And sometimes what we do, we put the rimmer of the intended graft size rimmer and see whether some of the posterior cortex is left behind, like 1 to 2 millimeter. If we are sure of that, then we can pass the guide wire through the rimmer in order to hit the femoral insertion point exactly. So then we do the sequential rimming. First, we drill with the 4.5 rimmer for the endobutton to pass through. And then we rim with the higher size rimmer. Now we are drilling with the 4.5 rimmer. and seeing how much of this posterior cortex is intact, so that with a larger size reamer, at least we should keep 1 to 2 millimeter of this intact cortex. Then we measure with the depth gauge. It is very important when we are going with a fixed loop, but with the adjustable loop, we just drill with the amount of tunnel we want to create, like 15 to 20 millimeter. And if you are using the fixed loop, then we create the tunnel 8 to 10 millimeter extra for the flipping of the end of a tunnel. Now, after creating the tunnel, you can see there is 1 millimeter or 1 to 2 millimeter of the intact posterior cortex. The graft part is drilled with a wider reamer and followed by the narrow reamer. So this you can see with your anterolateral portal or anteromedial portal. Now, the Freddy Poo has described the anatomical double bundle femoral tunnel concept, where he is recreating the anteromedial and the posterolateral bundle, and both of them are behind your ridge, and there the bifurcate ridge comes into play. The PL bundle is anterior or deep to the bifurcate ridge, and AM bundle is superior or above the bifurcate ridge. So you can see we were doing this double bundle tunnel technique in the earlier days, but with this transportal anatomical technique, we are no longer doing this kind of double bundle technique. Still, some surgeons, they prefer this double bundle technique. Now, all inside socket is created when we are dealing with a multi-ligament injury case, or when we want to conserve the bone, or when we are dealing with a pediatric case. Then we put the depth gauge and mark the 42% or 40% on the medial surface of the lateral femoral condyle. And then we see, and then we see the isometric point or the point on the insertion point on the femur by passing this offset jig. So that we check whether that 42% or 40% exactly matches with the point we are doing with the offset jig or not. So after doing that, you can see that it is just behind the intercondylar ridge and it exactly matches with that point. Now we put our outside in jig or all inside jig, so that point remains exactly at the center of the concavity of the jig. And then with the help of a flip cutter, we do the retro socket. So we pass the appropriate size flip cutter and it comes out exactly right there, and then it is flipped and the retro socket is created. And while creating this retro socket, you can mark the marker outside and you measure the tunnel size. So whether you want to do 15, 20, 25, you can mark from this marker. And once you do the appropriate size tunnel, then you go inward in the same manner. And then you unflip your flip cutter and then you take it out. And you have created nicely the femoral socket. So in this way, you can do the all inside socket. And the last is outside in technique. We can do for the revision scenarios. We can do it for the pediatric individuals in order to avoid the physis. Or we can do it for a single bundle reconstruction. In this case, we are going for a single PL bundle reconstruction where the AM bundle is intact. So we clean up the PL bundle area and then we put the jig and pass the guide wire to bring it exactly at the PL bundle insertion point. And we cross-check the posterior part and the position of the guide wire. And then with a reamer, we create this outside in tunnel for the skimmer of appropriate size. So once the tunnel is created, we clean the debris. And then the reamer is taken out. And then we pass the suture after seeing the posterior cortex. And once we pass the sutures, ideally we should put our guide wire in front of the suture so that your guide wire will be in front of the graft while fixing the graft, so as to avoid the tunnel blowout on the posterior aspect. So we hold it with a hemostat and we pass our PL bundle. And then we tighten it. And these are the various techniques by which we can create the different femoral tunnels in case of the ACL reconstruction. So to conclude, a positioning of the femoral tunnel should be done in correct position. It should not be too high or too low, or it should be deep in the notch and a decent amount, that is 1 to 2 millimeter of posterior cortex should be intact. And in this position, the graft will replicate isometric behavior of the native ACL. It will reconstruct the direct fibers. It will be placed eccentrically and equidistant and anatomically positioned and low in tension during the movements. Thank you for your patience.
Thanks, Dr. Ranjit. I think that was a very exhaustive talk.
Any questions? Mihir, unmute yourself, Mihir.
Ranjit?
Yeah. Yes. If there are no questions, I would like to ask a question.
Yes, yes. Please go ahead.
Yeah, Ranjit. So,
yeah.
Yeah. So we know that we have different notch configurations. Okay, you have the U-shaped notch and we have the V-shaped notch. The problem I always face, and I think most of us would have faced in a little mid-elderly or a young lady obese, who has a very narrow notch. And then approaching that femoral footprint from the AM accessory portal gets a little difficult. We can approach it, but the tunnel becomes too anterior, posterior, and too short. So any tips, tricks you follow in a case where you encounter a narrow tunnel?
Yeah. When we are getting a very narrow notch, first, I see it through the anterolateral portal, and many times it so happens, like I showed you in that video, that we just take it a normal tunnel as a narrow tunnel. So I go always to the anteromedial portal, and in the anteromedial portal, if I am seeing by passing the reamer of the appropriate size that the reamer is not passing freely, so that is the one point that I am getting a very narrow tunnel. And the second thing, if there are osteophytes in the elderly age groups, if I am seeing they are right there, then I go and take them out with a narrow osteotome or a burr to create a U-shaped notch, and then I go with the proper ACL reconstruction.
Ranjit?
Yeah, Binay.
Do you ever use this Mid-Patellar Poulter for doing this transportal technique? When there are osteophytes on the lateral femoral condyle, do you ever use this mid-patellar portal, or it's always anteromedial portal?
I always do anteromedial portal if there is no meniscal injury, unless until it is required. But most of the cases we have the meniscal injury. To deal with the meniscal injury, usually we do this mid-patellar portal.
So Ranjit, from your talk, like the take-home message is like, you are not going anatomical for femoral tunnel. You are believing in the concept of ideal, where we go slightly towards the anteromedial bundle, right?
Right.
Yeah, that's the message. Like the Freddy Fu has described his anatomical method of doing ACL reconstruction, but now you are going towards the slightly more anteromedial.
Anteromedial, yes.
Anteromedial, and directly towards the direct fibers.
Hi, Ranjit.
Doctor sir.
Yeah, yeah. How are you?
Fine, fine.
Yeah. Yeah, this is a question. See, someone wants to do some cases transtibial, some cases AM portal, through AM portal. So, what are the criteria to choose these patients? Do you have anything like that, patients to choose only for the transtibial or the transportal?
Yeah, I do most of my cases transportal only. Except in petal, when I am using this BTB, there I may use this transtibial technique, but most of my surgeries is through the transportal technique. But there are surgeons, they are very comfortable with the transtibial technique, and they exactly hit at the isometric or the insertional point of the ACL on the femoral condyle. Just by making your tibial jig more horizontal, and they take the outer part more medial, so that it will target right at the insertion point on the femur. But as I have told, it is creating, whatever you do, it is creating a oval hole, and it is not matching with exactly with the reamers. So I am not very confident on this transtibial technique. So I am going with this anatomical.
Yeah, Prasad.
Experience, we used to do transtibial 15 years back. A lot of cases we did. So what my observation is, patients with the transtibial is more comfortable in the patient. We have only anterior posterior instability.
Yes.
And when they have a rotational instability, these people won't be having a stability after your transtibial technique. So I think my opinion is only isolated anterior or posterior instability, transtibial gives a better result if you want to do transtibial. And if there is a component of rotational instability, I think anterior medial ACL gives a better results.
In obese patients, sometimes hyperflexion is not possible. And in adolescent child, when you want to do the vertical, purposefully vertical, ACL reconstruction, I think transtibial is a better option. And I still use transtibial for my high BMI patients where flexion is almost 90 only or maybe 100. I'm not comfortable with the transportal position. And I selectively, use this transtibial in those patients.
Yeah, in those conditions, the transtibial technique is a good tip. But right now, we are having this all inside jig. If you are having this all inside jig, there is no requirement of any hyperflexion. You can comfortably do in obese patients at 90 degree of knee flexion and children with the physis issues. So with this, we can avoid the complications what we were facing earlier. But yes, this is a nice thing to do with the transtibial technique in these scenarios, Dr. Sanjay has to.
Sanjay, you are using even flexible reamers.
I am exclusively using flexible reamers now.
Yeah. Then no need of doing
hyperflexion. I know, but...
And you can do it at 90.
Absolutely. But, we are discussing this, and in YouTube, there are many people who are really using non-flexible reamer, because like outside in or maybe a flip cutter, flexible reamers are also prone to high wear and tear, and, you need to replace it time and again. So cost is very high for the people. Most of, I think 90% of people are using, high flex position and standard reamers.
Yeah. So I think we'll proceed. Any more questions? Yes, Roshan sir, any questions on YouTube?
No, YouTube, I just...
One question. Mihir, looking at you, I get scared.
Okay. I am scary.
No, you are.
Something is sitting behind you.
Yeah. It looks like it will jump out of the screen.
Yeah, sir. I have taken inspiration from you. I remember you sitting all kinds of virtual background showing the entire universe behind.
There is a question on YouTube. Now you spoke about femoral tunnel, which are circulars, but
Robert Smilgeski and many of the French group, they're promoting the slots rather than the circular tunnels. Any opinion on that?
Yeah, if you're going with that concept, the slot technique, then you have to go with that technique, making a slot. And this circular or oval, this concept will not come into play when you are considering that concept. But when you are thinking the traditional, the anteromedial technique and transtibial technique, then you have to take into account the these two techniques, the oval hole or round hole, which you are getting with different techniques.
Yeah. Anil Patil, can you hear us, Dr. Anil Patil? I think Anil Patil, there is a problem. So I think Mir, we should proceed with Namdev's lecture. Namdev?
Yeah, so we'll call upon Dr. Namdev. He's going to discuss about the anatomical tibial tunnel for ACL reconstruction. Namdev, you can share your screen with us now. Dr. Namdev,
can you hear us?
Yes.
Yeah.
I think he's sharing.
So yes. Can you hear us?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes, you can't see you, so please share your screen. No, we are not able to see. So what you do is you open your presentation in desktop, then press on the zoom button, and then you share it. Share only presentation. There will be 2-3 windows. After that, one will be PPT window. So share that PPT window. Yeah, now we can see.
We can see
it. Yeah. And in video, in case your internet is, you can stop your video. So video will increase. Stopping your video will increase your
internet access.
Can you hear us, Namdev?
Can you see now?
No. We can see your. But we can't see your PPT. Can you open the PPT, Namdev?
Yes, hello. The connection, I think.
Namdev, can you hear us?
Hello. We can see his desktop.
Yes. 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 Can you see my presentation?
No, we can't see your presentation now. No. So what you do is you leave the stop sharing now. There is a button on top. You can
Hello?
See. Stop sharing. Now you open the PPT in your background. Namdev is gone. I think he disappeared. Okay. In that case, we'll. Anil, can you hear us? I think.
Anil is also not there.
The internet is there. Yeah. So in that case, we will go ahead with Vinay. Vinay, can you hear us, Vinay?
Yes.
We'll just wait for a minute. Then Namdev is joining. We'll just hi Namdev. No. Aik na. Tu te desktop madhe ughad and share only that window, the PPT window. Don't share your whole desktop. And now you press on Zoom. Press on Zoom. Share. मतलब तुला 3-4 windows दिखना. तो जब फक्त तुझी PPT जी window share कर. No, but you are not there on Zoom. I can't see you.
No, he's there. He's there. He just came.
He is there.
So what is happening is net is unstable. He is constantly logging in, logging out.
Mm-hmm.
can you start your hotspot also?
I think you should go. I think now you started sharing. Yeah, we can see it. Yeah.
Yes. Make it a PPT format, full screen, and stop your video. तेज़ा तुझे screen वर video button ऐसे ना बंद करो ना तो सोचा था. Yeah, Namdev.
Yeah, he's good. In the meantime, we could contact Anil Patil because he's still trying to connect since a very long
time. Yeah. Sandeep is trying to fix it. Namdev, we can go ahead with presentation.
As we know that,
Namdev, unmute.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Namdev was. Yeah, we can hear.
And the successful outcome of the ACL surgery depends on the proper tunnel placement. So the tunnel malpositioning cannot be overcome by the best graft, the best fixation method, and the best rehab. So in order to restore the normal knee biomechanics and the function, we should have the proper anatomical placement of the tibial and the femoral tunnels. And also to avoid the complications like the difficulty in flexing the knee joint, also the deformity like the extension lag because of the malpositioned tunnels. So some radiological studies have showed that almost in 10 to 14% of cases, there is a malposition of the tunnel. And this tunnel malposition is one of the main reasons for the ACL revision surgery. So to achieve the best tunnel positions, we have different aiming devices. That is, some devices are tip aiming devices, and some devices are the elbow aimer devices. So we can also use the SIAM while operating to see the. So we have some soft tissue and the bony landmarks while doing arthroscopy. So we can use that landmarks to make the tunnel more accurate. So when we have the native ACL remnant, I think that is one of the most important factor and which makes the tunnel more accurate. And also we can come to know the size of the footprint also. So if you see the morphology of the tibial, hello.
Hello, Namdev.
Hello, can you hear
me? Yes. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Yes, please go ahead, Namdev. We can hear you.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you. Please go ahead.
So this is all about the tibial footprint morphology and the location. As you know that the tibial insertion of the ACL is slightly larger and more stronger compared to the femoral side. So but the problem with the single bundle anatomical ACL reconstruction is that we're able to restore only the partial footprint of the native ACL. And usually the shape of the tibial ACL footprint looks like the duck foot shape or the horseshoe shape. So these are the specific landmarks. Some are bony landmarks and some are the soft tissue landmarks. So usually we have the medial and lateral tibial eminences, we have the ACL ridge, we have the ACL tubercle, medial and lateral tibial plateau, articular cartilage border, anterolateral fossa, and the retroeminence ridge. And the soft tissue landmarks are the anterior horn of the lateral meniscus and the anterior intermeniscal ligament. So in the next picture, I will show you all these landmarks and the relation of the tibial footprint. So if you see this picture, we have the shape of the tibial footprint, which looks like the duck foot shape. And usually it is about 10.5 millimeter just posterior to the anterior ridge and the ACL ridge and the ACL tubercle. And also it lies about 18 millimeter just medial to the anterolateral fossa. This anterolateral fossa is nothing but the area just medial to the lateral tibial plateau cartilage and just anterior to the lateral tibial eminence. And usually it lies 13 millimeter anterior to the retrohumerus ridge. This retrohumerus ridge is nothing but this is a transverse line just at the apex of the posterior tibial slope, just above the PCL tibial attachment. So another important landmark usually we can use to make the tibial tunnel is the we can use the soft tissue landmark, that is the anterior horn of lateral meniscus. So usually the tibial foot plate is 7.5 millimeter medial to the anterior horn of lateral meniscus. This ACL ridge and the ACL tubercle usually forms the anteriormost boundary of the ACL tibial footprint. No ACL insertion is located posterior to the lateral tibial spine, and also some surgeons use the PCL as a reference point for the ACL tibial footprint. So usually which lies about 7 millimeter anterior to the PCL. So we can also use the C-arm so it has got certain advantages, like it is very simple, non-invasive, cost effective, and we can reproduce accurate and more most reproducible method. It is especially useful in cases like when we are planning ACL augmentation, stump preservation, revision ACL surgery where we don't have the soft tissue landmarks, and also the chronic ACL avulsion fractures where we have the non-union and the malunion. So if we use the fluoroscopy, so usually we have to draw one line, that is a Amish-Jacob line, which usually lies at the top of the proximal tibia and which connects the two most wider parts of the proximal tibia, that is the anteroposterior line. So usually the center of the ACL lies at the 40% of the Amish-Jacob line from the front to back. So these are the different radiographic measurements of the anterocruciate ligament, which is used by the different surgeons. And what they conclude that, so usually the center of the anteromedial bundle is about,
Namdev,
take the average of
Namdev, may I suggest to close your video feed, so your audio will be good.
Dr. Rashim, you can close the Namdev video.
Line, the Rashim, center sir. Of the PL bundle is about 45%, and the average ACL center is at about 40% at the Amish-Jacob line. Yes, sir. Now you can hear, sir.
Yeah, we can hear clear.
Yes.
So there are certain advantages, and certainly there are certain advantages and disadvantages of this fluoroscopy techniques. It is inexpensive and easy to use and reproduce the technique, very short learning curve, and also we can mimic the anatomy of the ACL more. So,
Namdev, we can't hear you. Dr. Namdev, I think we have lost him.
We've lost him. I think he's disconnected.
Roshan, you could have shut his video feed.
Yeah, I tried my best. It is not happening. His internet is so poor that I cannot control it anymore.
Fortunate. He was coming to some interesting point.
Yes, sir. Namdev, can you hear us? Namdev?
Yes. Can you hear us? Can you hear me, sir?
Namdev, do one thing. Now you stop your video. You stop your video from your laptop.
Yes, continue yes. Screen sharing and audio, but shut the video.
Shut the video. And now you can share it. Yeah.
Now, sir, can you see?
Very unstable connection, sir.
Very unstable.
So these are the radiographic measurements of the anterior cruciate ligament tibial attachment using the Amish-Jacob line, and there are it has been proposed by the different authors. And usually what they conclude that the average anteromedial bundle center is usually lies at the 34% over the Amish-Jacob line. The center of the PL bundle is at about 45% at the over the Amish-Jacob line, and the center of the ACL lies at the 40%. Hello?
Yes.
Hello?
Yes, Namdev, we can hear you. Go ahead.
Hello?
Yes, Namdev, we can hear you.
Hello?
Namdev, we can hear you. Go ahead.
Can you hear me, sir?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yes. So there are certain advantages and disadvantages. Okay. So certain advantages of this technique. This fluoroscope is very easy to use and reproduce the technique. Very short learning curve and mimics the ACL anatomy more. So there are certain disadvantages like the radiation exposure, increased surgical time, and it has not been tested in the trans-tibial technique. So what are the complications if we have the malposition of the tibial tunnel? So if the tibial tunnel is too anterior, which ultimately results in the impingement of the graft against the intercondylar notch, ultimately there will be a loss of the extension and there will be a more tensile loads on the graft in full extension, which ultimately leads to the graft laxity and the failure. So what we can do to prevent the anterior placement of the tibial tunnel? So we should have the proper knowledge of the anatomy and the soft tissue bony landmarks. And so to a tibial tunnel placer, if you place the tibial tunnel accidentally, you can expand the tunnel and fill the tunnel with the graft, and you can use the supplemental fixation, like you can use the stacking screws to change the position of the graft. If the tibial tunnel position is too posterior, then the graft becomes more vertical, and the vertical graft will have very poor rotational stability, and also there is very ultimately that leads to the graft laxity and failure because of the repeated stretch of the graft in deep knee flexure. So again, to prevent, the treatment for this is to consider again expanding the tunnel and filling the posterior aspect of the graft and using supplemental fixation. So this is the take home message. Sometimes we can use a high anteromedial portal. We have the proper orientation of the tibial guide pin. So sometimes what happens if you look through the anterolateral portal, we are not medial or too lateral. So it's better to use the high anteromedial portal. So usually I start with a small reamer. There is a slight malposition of the tunnel. We can always change the position very easily. Then it's very important to use this CM or the fluoroscopy if it is available. And also, it is better to stick to the soft tissue and the bony landmarks, which are easy to reciprocate and easy to remember. So I'll show you the surgical video now. I will show you the surgical video now. 1 minute.
Your PPT has stopped. Hello.
I think he's sharing different directly video.
So usually, can you see the video, Sandeep?
No.
Now you have to start sharing your screen again.
Okay. One minute. Now?
Yes, we can see it.
So usually I perform a notchplasty of the medial border of the lateral femoral condyle. So whenever we are planning a ACL augmentation or a ACL preservation, a remnant preservation surgery, we can have more space to accommodate the ACL graft like this. then I will show you how. So usually I use the landmark, that is the anterior horn of the lateral meniscus. So usually I put my elbow MR slightly behind the posterior border of the anterior horn of lateral meniscus, and my aim of the tibial guide pin is at the center of the anterior horn of the lateral meniscus. So you can see the my elbow MR, which is in line with the posterior border of the anterior horn of lateral meniscus.
You can't see your elbow MR. Hello, Namdev?
Yeah.
Yeah, now we can see.
Now we can see.
Namdev, can you hear us? Namdev?
I think, sir, we have lost the connection
again. Again, I think we lost.
Hmm.
Let it be. Now, I think we should go on discussion. Namdev, can you hear us?
This tibial guide pin like ACL.
No, his video is not on Zoom.
Oh. Yes.
Okay, no problem. We'll have a discussion.
Yes, sir. So, I can hear you.
I think I am unable to stop sharing also. I don't know. Sandeep?
Sir, you make me call.
He is unable to do death also.
Arey vapre. Sir, no, use that arthroscopy academy laptop, sir.
No, I am able to make it. My net is not problem. I think his net is problem.
Yeah, now Sandeep, you are coached.
Done.
Yeah, he stopped sharing now.
So, I think his internet was very,
hello?
Very unstable.
Can you hear me, sir? Hello?
Sir, I think Namdev. We can go for the discussion.
Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, Namdev, we can hear you.
Now they stay back for discussion.
Yes.
Yeah, Namdev, what I would suggest is somehow your video was not playing. Could you maybe just conclude or give us some last concluding points for your talk before you start giving your discussion about your talk?
Voice is not clear, Nihir.
Hello? Hello.
Can you hear me?
Hello?
Can you hear?
Ha.
So Namdev, yes. Now that we can hear your audio, I would suggest that very shortly you should conclude your talk without sharing your screen before you start a short discussion.
Mir is also not
ready. Mir, you are also, your voice sound has become less.
Okay.
So
I think we can go ahead with the discussion.
Yes. I think we'll start.
Let's know from Samir Sheikh, Ranjit, and Sanjay how they. Sonendo, can you hear us, Sonendo? Just to know what exactly is their landmark for the tibial tunnels.
Sorry, Dr. Sonendo's internet is a problem.
Yeah. Samir.
With so much of talk going around for stump preservation, ACL reconstruction.
Mm-hmm.
How important are these landmarks and this centimeter, that millimeter? So are they so relevant with so much of talk going on about stump preservation?
Let's start with the negative. Who is using image intensifier for the tibial tunnel routinely?
No one.
So, and with remnant preservation, I use my remnants as a reference to my tibial tunnel, and I use tip aimer and I find out the center and put my tip aimer little bit behind that center, so posterocentral, and then I use successive reamers and try to reorient my tunnel, if tibial tunnel, if it is required. So if my graft is 9, I will start from 7, 8 and then go to the 9, and every time I will just try to readjust if I find that this is not going in a correct position. And I would try to take it more to away from the lateral femoral condylar wall if it is moving towards that, because we are biased by view of anterolateral viewing portal. So that is my strategy. But very honestly, I struggle still to do a perfect femoral and perfect tibial tunnel very often, because whole anatomy is different, and you know, at the end of the procedure, often I feel that this tunnel could have been little better on the femoral side, or sometimes this tunnel could have been slightly better on the tibial side. I always do my femoral little bit of scraping of notch on the lateral wall, so that I can view it better. I don't routinely use anteromedial viewing portal type or central viewing portal, but that is not a big problem. But it is easy surgery, ACL, but to do it precisely and reproduce it every time precisely, it's not joke actually. You have to have patience, and you have to go it do it very slowly. That's my view.
Every time you keep your jig in the middle, or you keep little medially, sir?
Center of the ACL remnant. And they are always there unless there has been old tibial spine. They are always there.
Dr. Namdev is there. I think we can ask him.
Like, what I feel, like just we have to see the ACL remnants. That is one important thing. But along with that, again, you have to keep in mind two things. That you have to, if you have to err on the negative side, please don't go laterally. You have to be on the medial side. And second thing is your posterior horn of the lateral meniscus, anterior horn of the lateral meniscus, posterior bottom. These all three things you have to keep in mind. And then you have to go for tibial tunnel, what I feel. And definitely, if the tunnel is beyond 8 mm, you need to go gradual, like 7 mm, then 8 mm, and then 9 mm. You have to go. If it's 8 mm, that can be directly, you can go ahead with the 8 mm if you are not sure that you are in the center of the movement.
Most of the time, I keep on doing minor adjustment for the tibial tunnel, most of the time.
Sanjay, how you can avoid that, like if you are doing a gradual reaming, like suppose now you have started with 7 mm, right? So 7 mm you have done, then while doing 8 mm, you are holding the guide wire from inside.
So it is in the center,
You are holding the guide wire. After holding the guide wire from inside, or you are fixing it in the femur and doing the 8 mm, then you are doing 9 mm. Somehow what I feel, like the tunnel what we are expecting, like if you are expecting a 9 mm tunnel, you get a 10 mm tunnel.
So let me tell you, then how I hold it, I do not take it out to the femoral and lock it there. I use some grasper, and if I think I need to move it little posterior, I take my tip towards posterior. If I think that I need to go medially, I take my tip medially, and then every time I will not come fully out. If I'm adjusting, I'll just, my reamer will remain just at the mouth where I can see from inside the joint. And yes, it is slightly enlarged, but in TBI, I use interference screw, and I always use 1 plus most of the time. So it's not a big problem actually.
Yeah, that's the point what I want to bring. Like when you are doing this gradual reaming, 7 mm, 8 mm, 9 mm, usually interference screw is the one what graft fixation choice should be.
Now, in cases of sequential reaming, are you perforating every time the tibial plateau or not? My question is, if your guide wire is exactly spot on, is it necessary to perforate every time the tibial plateau? Instead, we can do sequential reaming up to the resistance, and the final one, if you will perforate, will that solve the problem or what?
No, then you won't go medial or posterior or anterior.
You're not perforating.
Roshan, what's your view? What is your strategy?
My strategy is always I go ahead with standardized tibial tunnels, always try to do it at the anatomical position where ECL is there, the footprint. Radiological use is not that important, but I think recreating anatomy, that to where it is. So I'll just share few of the video pictures, if allow me. Just a minute. I'll share with you. Can you see this now?
Yeah, we can see.
Yeah? So, yes. Knee at 90 degree and ACL. So, Sanjay bhai, you can see the complete anatomy of ACL footprint here. You can see the
yes.
entry
yes.
horn of
sure.
lateral meniscus. And
yes, yes.
You can easily find out where exactly is your ACL tunnel in case
yes.
you are not doing the remnant preservation. In case you are doing remnant preservation, then there is a problem. But still, you can manage it with the tip MR or the angle. Angle MR is very difficult to handle. Tip MR is very easy to handle. And this is how it should look like. Am I right?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So this is how it should look like. And final drilling, you can see a very good circular hole, which is not going toward on the lateral meniscus, neither it is going on to the medial tibial plateau. Yeah?
Yeah.
Hello? Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Intraoperative fluoroscopy, somebody spoke, but you know, that is not our regular practice. So this is how I do it.
Roshan, for double bundle, what is your strategy?
Double bundle, yes, we do lot of double bundle, but double bundle, we don't, you know, it's very difficult. Again, I will share the Zoom with you how we do it. It's very critical to see what exactly and where exactly you are planning to. Just a minute. You can see here now. So this much of tibia, and once you see the anatomical attachment of the tibia, almost 40% from the front to the back AP diameter. Dr. Namdev was speaking about MS and Jacob line, and that line will be divided at around 44%, which shows a perfect anatomical attachment. And when you talk about the double bundle, I think there you have to analyze the two attachment of the both the tunnels. You know, it has to be at least somewhere near the 37%, and the rest of it can be done as a 44%. So your ACL has to be more of anterior structure rather than the posterior structure close to the PCA. Yes?
Yes.
Yeah. So that is my viewpoint.
Namdev wanted to add something.
Namdev?
Regarding the gradual reaming, actually, once you make the initial reamer with like 5 mm or 6 mm, once we come to know that we have the accurate tibial tunnel placement, then directly we can reamer like 1 mm, 8.5, 9 mm. Like, not necessary to do like gradual, like 7, 8, 9, 10, like that. So once you are doing, using multiple reamers, then we are enlarging the tibial tunnel. So what I feel, use a small reamer one, confirm the position of the tunnel, and then directly use the definitive culture. And the consistent soft-systemic primer could be, I use the anterior horn of the lateral meniscus. So I think that is more than enough.
Okay, I think if there is no more...
One more. Who among us is using coring reamer or impaction or dilator? That is very interesting to know. Dilator. So share your experience, Ranjit.
Yeah, in all cases, when I am using the unipotential tunnel or convergent tunnel, usually I ream one size less. Unless otherwise it is a very robust man, very strong bone, I do one size less. And then with the sequential dilatation, I do the dilatation. So that you will have a very secure fixation and a good hold with the balance.
Having.
Any literature support for that or any obvious study, superiority?
One study is there where they are using like this. I am not able to tell that study, but I have read that. And they are using both for femoral and tibial, and they regularly do use these dilators for all their cases. And they are getting very good result with this kind of technique.
And even, that's two size less. They ream two size less.
Oh, okay.
Sanjay bhai, that the paper, it was there in 2012 or 2010.
That is why. There is nothing. Yeah, I searched recently. It was
when we started 10-12 years back. Even initially, we started doing the dilatations and see it promotes osteogenesis, and these all papers are there. But in clinical practice now, I don't think it's of use.
Exactly. So I wanted to know.
Sanjay, see.
Dilators, but coring rimas, I'll tell you.
Yeah, when we are skeptical about the tunnel diameter, that it is increasing by 1 millimeter, so what is the harm in under rimming and dilating?
No harm.
No harm.
I totally accept it.
We used to use these dilators in almost 15 years back, where Dr. Devesh Vidyasagar used to do, and we used to.
Yes.
So the problem is in femoral side, tibial side, no problem. But tibial side, when you are doing this with the dilators, this is a solid one, actually. It's not like it won't remind. It just you have to dilate. When there is a more pressure, there may be some chances of getting a different sound, and you have to remove in between and do your reaming. So that will be the problem. I think few years, like 3-4 years, there was like this type of impaction grab reaming was there. Then it was gone away because there was no studies supporting that.
Okay. Yeah. Coring reamer, Samir was telling something about it.
Yeah. Coring reamers, similar to like dilatation, what we say, initially when it came, we started using it. But somehow we found that it's of no use in our routine practice to use core reamers. But definitely in revision scenario, we do use the core reamers where we need some graft for that. And sometimes if your non-anatomical tunnel is there and you need a graft on the femoral side, that graft can be used from the tibial side, and that you can impact it on the femoral side. That is useful.
Sure. Yes, Roshan, go ahead now.
Yeah, I think we should move on to the last talk by Dr. Hello, Vinay, can you hear?
Yes, sir. Yes, I'm here.
Please share your screen so that we'll finish last talk. Anil Patil is unable to join us because of his internet issue. Yeah, Vinay, can you share your screen?
Yes, I've shared it. Now what?
No. Open your PPT in desktop and then share only PPT. Vinay, can you hear us?
Yes, I can hear, sir.
We are unable to see your screen. So what I'll request you is you stop sharing again.
Okay.
And then open your presentation in desktop.
Mm-hmm.
Then press on to Zoom button. Zoom on lower bar. Zoom icon. Then you'll see whole desktop in your Zoom icon.
Mm-hmm.
So there you'll see your PPT on one of the icons, one of the desktop models. You press on that and then again share it.
Can you see?
No, we can't see. So what you should do is open your presentation in your desktop.
Mm-hmm.
Now again, press on Zoom. Zoom, have you pressed on Zoom?
Yes, so I can see myself only.
So Zoom, you go to green button on Zoom. There is a green button called share.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So, okay, now we can see. Okay, start, play the presentation. I'll mute everyone. Okay. Yeah, you can go ahead. You can go ahead. I am mute everyone.
We go ahead with the last talk of the session. That's about tibial graft fixation.
Okay, you can go ahead, Vinay.
Okay. So I would like to go into some historical perspective of how things evolved regarding fixation of graft. So it started in 1914 when Greco in Russia drilled tibial tenons in tibia and femur and stitched free facial artery grafts to femur and tibia periosteum. So this was the initial method of fixation wherein the ACL graft was fixed by suture fixation. And this was the method which was there for about two decades, wherein ACL was done using suture fixation as the method of fixation. In 1950s and 60s, innovations happened, things evolved. And in 1956, boat nail was used as cortical post by Augustine for graft fixation and tensioning. In 66, Bruckner for Germany used cortical button on the femoral side and press fit for the tibial side. Now, these terminologies we use quite often now. So then 1969, Frenke gave concept of interference graft fixation using bone tendon bone grafts. So initial choice of graft was patellar graft, and there was nothing like hamstring graft. In 70s and 80s, Galloway gave the concept of non-anatomic extra-articular ACL fixation with sutures and staples. In 87, Hurtle proposed implant-free PESFIT ACL reconstruction using a PTB graft. And this was the method which became very popular in 80s and 90s. A modification was done by Pessler, who reported implant-free PESFIT ACL reconstruction using hamstring graft. The only difference from Hurtle was it was a PTB graft and this was a hamstring graft. The fixation methodology was same. In 80s, a lot of innovations happened, and the most significant was Kurosaka's innovation, where he used headless interference screws in cadavers for fixation of PTB graft. And then PTB with metal interference screw became the gold standard, which was called as aperture fixation close to the joint line. Fredman revolutionized the use of free hamstring graft, and along with Pingzewski, who used blunt threaded metal interference screws for soft tissue graft, there was a shift which happened in 1990s. When the shift came for soft tissue graft in place of patellar tendon graft, a lot of people started using soft tissue graft. Again, the 1980s saw the emergence of endobuttons pioneered by Rosenberg, which is the most widely used ACL graft fixation on the femoral side. Pessler again in 1994 used cross pin and corticocancellous suspensory fixation for PTB graft fixation. Clark modified this method using again cross pin corticosuspensory fixation for soft tissue graft. And this was done in 1998. And this method became very popular and was popular for next 10 years before it faded down. So out of all these innovations, we finally landed up with basically two fixation methods. One is intra-tunnel fixation method, and then the extra-tunnel fixation method. Intra-tunnel fixation was with screws, and it was dependent on what kind of screw we are using, what is the design, what is the bone quality, and what is the placement of screw. Extra-tunnel fixation method was with buttons, staples, and posts. Extra-tunnel fixation had some concerns because the fixation was away from the joint, like bungee effect and windshield wiper effect. Going to the biomechanics of ACL reconstruction, ultimate load to failure in ACL reconstruction for PTB graft is 3000 Newton and the hamstring is 4000 Newton, which is not a problem. The problem was fixation load to failure, which was 500 Newton. And this is precisely the force that a reconstructed ACL is subjected to on the daily basis, about 150 to 500 Newton. So the fixation is the weakest link in the early post-operative period, wherein the force that the ACL is bearing every day is equal to the force which is the fixation is having. So biomechanics of fixation was like, what was the fixation device? It should have a good strength, which means load to failure. It should have good stiffness, which means resistance to displacement. And it should be very less in slippage, means change in initial position should be very less. So again, fixation was the weakest link. And among the two, femoral and the tibial side, tibial fixation is the weakest link. Why? Because there's the bone density of the distal femur is more than the proximal tibia. And the angle of forces is in line with the graft, which is in the case of the tibia, not in the case of the femur. And then bone strength falls away from the joint line, wherein the tibial fixation devices are holding the graft on the tibial side. So these are the three factors which make tibial fixation the precarious one in the initial rehabilitation phase of ACL reconstruction. Another thing is graft motion, which has to be taken into account when we are thinking of the fixation methodology of ACL reconstruction is graft motion. There are three types of graft motion which are there: bungee effect, which is longitudinal motion, windshield wiper effect, which is a horizontal motion, and a creep. And more than 3 millimeter of motion is interfering with the graft incorporation. So we have to be very wary of what kind of fixation methodology we are using on the femoral side or on the tibial side. This graft motion can cause tibial widening, which is more with non-aperture kind of fixation. So going to the aperture fixation, in this fixation, the graft motion is less, which is a preferred fixation. And the factors which are affecting the fixation is the factors related to screws, the geometry and the material, and the screw divergence, and the bone density, and the torque of insertion. Taking one by one, screw factors are basically of the geometry and the material. For soft tissue grafts, longer screws are better. Screw diameter should be 1+, and screws should be with blunt threads. For bone plug grafts, the length of the screw should be only much to be engaging the bone plug, and same screw diameter or one size less is preferred. For bias screw came, the revision was easy. It was MRI compatible, but breakage, tissue reaction, and tunnel widening is an issue with bias screw, especially on the femoral side. Bias screws cause a lot of tunnel widening. At 6 weeks, 60% lot of stiffness with a bias screw is a concern, which is still there. Going by the material used for the screws, polyglycoloid absorbs early, may cause loosening of fixation, and polylactide take years to absorb, may cause some tissue reaction. For the torque of insertion, more resistance, better fixation, more with the metal screws. Just we discussed about this, better if prepared by tunnel dilatation. So what was the method is, reaming initial was done by 2 millimeter less, and sequential dilatation was done, and this improved the torque of insertion, thereby giving better fixation. Screw divergence, it is proven in various studies that more than 20 degrees of divergence of screw will compromise the stability of the graft. Poor bone density is another factor which has to be taken into account, and it is recommended to use a hybrid fixation on the tibial side if we have a bone which has a density which is poor, especially in Indian females. Suspensory fixation, the graft tunnel motion is more, it may lead to tunnel widening. Clinical outcome, there is no difference. First generation were fixed loop devices, and second generation they are variable loop devices like Tiotrope, RTN. Now a lot of companies are coming with this. So going for TBI ACL fixation, graft with bone plug, we can use interference screw, staple fixation, or post fixation. For soft tissue graft, staple fixation, it can be single staple or preferably a double fixation, which is belt buckle technique, and screw spike washer, screw fixation, post or interference. So these are the methods of fixation of soft tissue or graft with bone plugs like bone petal and bone. The take home message is early post-op fixation is the weakest link. Tibial fixation is the weakest link in early post-op period. Clinical outcome of various devices are comparable. There is no lot of difference. Tunnel widening is a concern. Aperture fixation is more stable. Interference screw are still the gold standard, giving quite a good rigidity and stiffness to the construct. Tunnel dilatation improves function, which is, as we discussed, not practiced very often now. Thank you.
Any questions to Dr. Vinay on his wonderful presentation on facial fixation devices? Mihir? Jayaprasad?
Vinay, most of the times, the tunnel screw divergence like more than 20 degrees or 10 degrees and when we are putting a guide wire inside, sometimes it will come out and again we are putting it may little deviates and sometimes Smith and a few other screws that guide wire is a very thin, so it will deviate even when you have a axis of different axis, it will go into that side and then it will come into the, so divergence of 10 to 20 degrees, it is almost, and then if you are not careful, it will go into divergence. But what is the other fixation you will advise for the, like if you are thinking that suddenly it will diverge
on Siam, or you thought that intraoperatively, yes, this is little diverged. So the graft is not fixed, you are not satisfied. What are the other fixation you will give the at the tibial side with this?
So in that case, if one is sure while they are putting the screws that it is not holding well, or it has diverged in some other plane, then we may use an accessory fixation or hybrid fixation in form of a staple. Yeah. So you can use a staple, one can use a post to help the interference screw fixation. In that case, if you feel that interference screw is not holding well on the graft.
Yeah, yeah. Staples, we have screws, we have sometimes post. You can have the, through the bone also, you can have the fixation. So the staples, sometimes the staples will give a lot of bigger holes on the tibia. So do you advise the staples or something else?
You know, I think post is another option, but there is a study which has come up just now which says staple doesn't give accessory additional fixation. It does cause some hardware issues with the staples. This is the study recently which has come from Korea, which says this.
Okay.
I'm using staples. I'm using staples whenever I'm in doubt regarding my fixation on the interference screw side, I use staples.
Yeah.
Anybody using anything else?
I use screws, small screws, because it will have a strong fixation, both bicortical fixation on the lateral side and medial side. Then I will tie the threads. That gives a better fixation than the step. Because sometimes what happens is metaphysically the steps, when you are tying with the your strength, then suddenly the staple will come out. So those are the issues I have perceived during surgery. So when I want to do a second fixation, I will go for the screw fixation.
Yeah, screw post is a better fixation than staple. Anybody else? Anybody else on tibial fixation? Anybody else? Ranjit?
Yeah, Vinay.
Yes, Ranjit. Hello. Yes, Ranjit. Yeah.
You put your screw on the tibial side, posterior to the graft or anterior to the graft?
So initial to start, I used posterior method because that was being taught by my teacher. But now I put my graft on the anterior side, not on the posterior side.
Is there any difference putting it anteriorly?
Can I ask one question?
Yes. Ranjit, it is sometimes not in your hand. Sometimes screw goes wherever it wants to go.
What I do is I take out all my four tendons, you know, separate them and go through the center. Like
that's a device which Mitek has, I think, devices.
But that is, you know, that is where you have to use sheath and then.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. You have devices.
So it's very expensive one. Which is
for that sake, you need a long graft.
Yeah. So
that we get, but this device is not there. It's with Mitek, I think.
Yeah.
Mitek is giving this device.
It's called Intrafix.
Intrafix.
We used to use that, but I think that technique is very good. You expand all your threads, give two threads in your assistant hand, keep two with you, hold the position of the leg, and then keep tightening it. So it will go in that direction. That is one, because you are putting a guide wire and there is a constant tension by the assistant. Or else you can use the device which is created by Mitek. There is a tensionometer. Through that tensionometer, you tension your graft, maybe 20 pounds, and then you fix the screw with your long screwdriver. Where you can.
Even with that Intrafix, I was not able to keep it in the center. Sometimes the strand would wind around the screw and
that is a
realistic
possibility.
There is a technique to it. So what you do is when you are using a graft, always put your screwdriver before inserting the graft and try to rotate it. Just see whether your graft is rotating.
Right.
Graft is rotating, you can know which thread of the graft is rotating. If this is rotating, you can tell your assistant to pull it. This is rotating, you can tell your assistant to pull it. So if you give a good tension and then you tighten. Okay.
So you need two assistants.
You always have two assistants. Come on, in India we don't have
Roshan is a big boss. He will have three assistants. The KEM ka boss hai.
So Roshan boss hai.
How many of us are using tensionometer?
No one.
I use it.
किस कंपनी का आता है वो तो बताओ
कौन सी कंपनी का आता है
Mitek का आता है I brought it around.
But 10. I think that is not available in India, I think. If it is marketed in India?
Yes, yes, it's available. I use it in my hospital. I've been using since last 10 years.
It is a How much tension instrument. You give?
You can, there is a graduation in that tensionometer. You can tension it to 20 pound or you can make it 30 pound depending on your strength. So if you have a very fantastic good athletic population, graph quality is good, you can give 30 pound tension also. So it's a very good device to check the tension on your graph.
Sometimes putting those 10, 11 bioscrews, a layer of the outer layer comes out from the screw.
Is it Ranjit happened once with me?
Yeah, Ranjit, I, hello?
Yes, yes.
Ranjit, these things will happen with the peak screws. That thread part is comes out when you make a initial thread part will a small strip is will come out and then it won't go seal. So that will be when you are putting the screw initial thread part when going in, you have to be very careful. I think I also have perceived this. One or two cases I have taken out the screw and seen what is the problem. When we are pushing initial part, that thread part will become a small part will go off, then your screw won't go inside. And another thing is that thread part, initial thread part will get compressed and it will become smooth. So you won't get purchase. These two problems will be there in the peak anchors, the peak screws. So my after that, what I am doing is I'm putting a little hold on that, then when it after getting purchase of one thread, then you can have the complete.
Yeah, my question to Dr. Sanjay is when you have fixed the femoral side and tibial side, you were fixing with metallic interference tube, and then the graft is amputated and all your epigon and part of graft came out. Now, how will you get out?
Right. So, first thing, I have never used metallic screw for the soft tissue graft, but I have had this problem where when I was using ethibonds, I had this, cut through of the ethibond and I was left without, one strand, without any, sutures. I opened my tibial tunnel little bit, got the few sutures into my one bundle of that, and then I used a backup post, and from that day onwards I never use ethibond. Now I am using shoulder sutures, ultra braid or other sutures, and that is now 8 years now. And whatsoever has happened to my bio interference screw, I never had a thread cutting with this shoulder sutures. But that was very unfortunate, and that is a very dicey situation, and it gives you a lot of grief. I just opened my tibial tunnel by, little bit of nibbling, and I had a tough time actually, and I was almost, I solely practice in private, and when something like this happens, it becomes day one failure, and I was so scared, but then slowly I managed it, and I immobilized very slowly and stuff like that. I preserved the chips and I just, put it there and sutured periosteum over that. But I knew that it was futile. The 10 millimeter of my tunnel was open.
I'll tell you a practical tip. Whenever you have an amputation of the graft, if your amputation is very close to the tibial tunnel,
you can take it out. Yeah.
Yeah. What you can go is you keep your femoral fixation in, get your suture retrieval, and retrieve your graft from the anterolateral portal, because that is the nearest portal, anterolateral portal. Then prepare your graft. One by one, you pull it back from the anterolateral portal into the tibial tunnel. And then you can do either a bioscrew fixation or you can use the suspensory type of fixation, depending on your situation. So I have done this in one case where had an issue. There is a amputation of the graft while using the this size bias screw, and then I have to go from into the joint, retrieve it in. In case you are not using the adjustable loop device, it's more easy. You have not removed the other side. No, you are using a fixed endo loop
threads.
Endo button. You can reverse your fixed endo button, and you can take out the complete graft and redo the graft and redo it again. In case graft is insufficient, then you have to choose for other graft. Like either quadriceps or BTB, depending on the
Dr. Ranjit. Hello. Hello.
Yeah, Namdev. Yeah.
What another you can do, like initially I was in size 2 inch one, but nowadays I'm in size 5 inch one. And usually there will be 4 stands of size 5 inch one on my tibial side graph. So usually it doesn't cut with if you are using a 1+2 or 2+2, unless and until you are using a very sharp titanium screw, then I think this is the case. And mostly there will not be any problem with the bias screw, so very I think last 3-4 years I don't have any the suture cut out at the tibial end of the graft. So because of that, I have started using the size 5 inch one.
Okay. Yeah, I think if we don't have any questions, yes, Vinay, last question.
Has anyone ever used 2+ size screw on an Indian female kind of? So anybody ever used 2+ size with the bias screws?
Yeah, I have used. Like if there is an osteoporotic bone.
Indian female.
If you feel like, Indian female's osteoporotic bone, you can see it pre-op also, even in intra-op, you can feel while doing the tunnel. Tibial tunnel. That time you can use +2 screws on the tibial side.
One side will come out like as if it has not fixed anything.
Yes. You don't get that sound. The squeaking sound you don't get.
Yeah.
How do you decide? After opening the screw? Or,
No. Before. Once if you have started drilling, that time the drill feel you will get like whether it's a soft bone or it's a hard bone. And depending on that, you can go ahead. And you know how much diameter of the graft is there. Sandeep, that will again decide.
So what are you, I just put my trocar inside the tunnel. So if trocar goes through and through very easily, I know this is, I think, 2+. So if trocar is like going very hard, the scope trocar, that means I can go one size up. So that's like my technique.
Yeah. Oh, very good. Nice to know.
Okay, I think we should end the meeting because this is a nice discussion.